Let's go ahead and start. For those of you who don't know me, this is recording, so I'll put on the whole show. For those of you who don't know me, my name is
Matt Rowe. I'm with the Environmental Health and Safety Department. And what the VPR's office wanted to do is kind of give a brief introduction to what EH&S, or Environmental Health and Safety, does on campus, go over some of the programs that we watch over and kind of coordinate to give you a lay of the land, so to speak, of what we do and what we're here for and how we serve the community here at Texas Tech. So what are we? EH&S is a department of 20 personnel in broken down into four sections. One section is laboratory safety, which coordinates both chemical and biological safety. There's also an occupational safety section that oversees occupational safety and health for faculty, staff, and student. There's a radiation, laser, and magnetic field safety office where we oversee the protection of workers working in radioactive labs in using lasers and also in magnetic field safety. And then there is an environmental protection and public health group that makes sure that the environment is protected and regulations are met and the needs of the public health are met here at Texas Tech. And why are we here? The primary mission of EH&S is to develop and implement environmental and occupational health and safety programs to support the university's teaching, research, and service to the community. So that primary goal is reflected in all the programs that we run and all the sections that we run. And it's the focus of what we're here to talk about today. The goal is to meet the needs of the students and faculty and staff of the institution and to provide for their safety in the most efficient and cost-effective manner possible. What do we do? In terms of, in broken down in sections, in laboratory safety, we oversee chemical hygiene. This can include exposure control, primarily through personal protective equipment like gloves and lab coats, exhaust ventilation, and maybe needle safety, sharp safety. These are all things that are reflected in the chemical hygiene plan that is available on our website. We also oversee safe storage of chemicals and hazardous materials. Facilities development, that includes plans review of new proposed facilities and also renovating facilities that currently exist. And then of waste management of all hazardous materials, hazardous waste that's generated in the laboratories. And biological safety and security, well, those two things go hand in hand. We look at exposure control, again, primarily through personal protective equipment and exhaust ventilation, or what they would call ventilated cabinets. Also with sharp safety, that kind of thing. And then also waste management, removing the biological waste and make sure it's properly disposed of. We also oversee physical hazards in the laboratories. This could include ergonomics, noise, thermal stresses, and vibrations, those kinds of things that can, and various other things that can be a part of any elaborate research program. We also, in this direction, we coordinate, our office primarily coordinates the major research safety committees. These include the Institutional Laboratory Safety Committee, the Radiation Laser Safety Committee, and the Institutional Biosafety Committee. For occupational safety, these programs that we implement are primarily based in OSHA regulations. These include hazardous communication, that making sure that bottles are properly labeled and that workers that are working in an area with hazardous materials, they know what those materials are. Forklift powered truck safety, so if your work includes working on a man lift or a forklift, that the person driving it and the person operating it has proper instruction and training and is made sure that's provided for. Ladder safety, fall protection, working at heights, confined space entry. This is a fairly elaborate program where any time a worker of Texas Tech has to enter into what is defined as a confined space where it's difficult to move or there might be a hazardous environment, we oversee the entry into that space and make sure that the worker has a means of rescue. Bloodborne pathogen exposure, those that are working around human blood and body tissues, they are offered and medical surveillance and are maintained in a program for their protection. Respirator fit testing, this would be anyone who needs to use a respirator on campus, making sure they're properly using it and that they can help use it and are checked out by a doctor annually. Powered machine guarding, this would be shop safety, that kind of thing. Crane hoist safety, electrical safety, indoor air quality, making sure that the workplaces of Texas Tech are safe to work in if there's a difficult, maybe mold or some other issue that comes up, we address those issues as well. And ergonomics. These are primarily OSHA and NFPA programs that are based in our occupational safety program. For the radiation laser safety and magnetic field safety, anytime magnetic fields over half a millitesla are used, those are higher. We address the safety concerns there, the primary concern being medical implants being affected. Anytime lasers are used, especially class 3B and 4, then training needs to be provided and engineered in safeties need to be provided to protect the user and other people in the laboratory. Radioactive sources, radioactive materials, and radiation producing equipment like x-ray machines, those are checked on a regular basis and we make sure that they have had training, all the users have had training, and maintain a vigorous auditing program on their own to make sure that any waste is treated appropriately and they're not having any accidental releases of the material. In environmental protection and public health, these two go hand in hand. These are primarily EPA and the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality programs and the Texas Department of State Health Service programs. This includes air permitting, stormwater permitting, industrial wastewater permitting, hazardous waste pickup and disposal, waste metals and light bulb recycling, food establishment inspection and making sure that the public health is addressed through food establishments. Pest control for the large majority of the campus is that contract is orchestrated through our department. And swimming pool inspections during the summer to make sure that they're being maintained in a safe fashion. What I wanted to do a little bit today is go into some of what we do for preventative programs. These are some new programs or programs that we're more fully developing in the last few months. One of the programs is a scans program. This is a safety concerns and near miss system. And let me, it's available on our website. And what I'd like to do is, you can go to our website and click on the button down in the left-hand side and you can bring up a safety concerns and near miss form. It's a form that can be filled out. It can be anonymous. The name is not required. And allows the users at large all over Texas Tech to send us a safety concern if they see a loose hand railing or a walkway that's unlevel, someone that they feel is being unsafe in their operation of an equipment, something like that. They can do that without fear of reprisal. And also, it's a reporting system for near misses. So if you're working in, say, a laboratory and an accident was narrowly averted, there was no damage done, no one was hurt, but the realization is there was a potential there for damage. It could have been extreme, maybe a fire was put out quickly, no long-term damage, but it was possible it could have been much worse. You can let us know about that as well. The goal of this system, especially the near-miss system, is to help find the root cause of what was the originating issue and try and fix that problem. See if we can prevent that problem in the long term. Hopefully with these near misses, we can address issues in other labs that do similar research or might have similar operations. Or if it's a near miss in maybe a workplace setting, like a staff workplace setting, maybe it was a ladder issue where the ladder failed. Maybe we need to have a ladder inspection program, or maybe something that could have happened we can prevent in the future. It allows us to address those issues before they do become accidents. Another preventative program that it has been established in the past, but we're trying to develop it more, is the investigations and lessons learned program. What EH&S does after an accident, we would come in and do an investigation, especially in a lab setting or a workplace setting. We'll come in and do an investigation on behalf of the university, and we will create a report that it can help the university administration make better decisions about how to prevent those issues in the future. We also help coordinate the implementation of recommendations from these reports. And to give you a little example about what that would look like, we have a Safety at TTU website that's in the VPR's website section. What we do is we write these reports up. These reports are available for anybody to look at, and we do our best to protect the people involved, but we want to make sure that the university as a whole can read these at their leisure and hopefully go back and implement the recommendations at their work site. In this case, we can even provide some we can help implement the recommendations if it was like an engineering control. Like in this particular issue, there was an issue with improper waste storage. So we provided a engineering solution through vented caps, which are basically caps that fit on the waste and don't allow pressure to build up, which is the root cause of this problem. So I think this is an effective way to going forward to helping us eliminate these repetitive issues that occur in the workplace. So in summary, some of the responsibilities that we have include laboratory safety, with the focus of being protecting workers in the community during the use of hazardous chemicals and biologicals in the course of research. Occupational safety, protecting workers during the course of their employment. Radiation, laser, magnetic field safety, protecting workers while using radiation, radioactive equipment, radiation producing equipment, lasers, and high strength magnets. And environmental protection, making sure that Texas Tech is a good steward of the environment and meeting the regulations that are outlaid by federal and state mandate. And then also public health responsibilities, making sure that the general population is eating in healthy restaurants, swimming in healthy swimming pools, and making sure that we don't have a problem with pests in the environment. That's really just an introduction to EH&S. And then I'd be willing to take any questions for discussion. Yeah?
You talked about the near miss reporting system.
Yes.
What do you do to advertise that and to get people to really encourage people to report and build a database?
Right. This will actually be the first time we've shown this off to the public in this forum here. I'm working with Sally here to help distribute the information. We're probably gonna send out some flyers, do some tech announce. We're gonna put on our website a more clear definition of what the scan system is for our website and include it in all of our trainings. This was actually the end result of the Chemical Safety Board who investigated the explosion. In 2010, they recommended this be implemented, and it was very difficult to come up with a system that worked in a university setting. I think this system goes on in industry quite a bit, but they couldn't figure out a really good way to do it here at a university, and so this is pretty much the first try Texas Tech has taken at it. What the form does is it collects all the data into a database, and then we have a follow-up on what we did. So we'll go and do an investigation of if it's a safety concern or a near miss. If someone had a fire in a lab, we'll go in and try and find out what the problem was and see if there was some what the root cause was, so we can fix it. Much like we would do if there was an accident, only this doesn't result in an accident. No one gets hurt and there's no damage done. And for the safety concerns, we thought we would add that as well, because we've heard some criticism, I guess, but from students particularly, that they wanted a way to send information to us. We would get emails and kind of dribs and drabs of, you know, this step outside of the sub is loose or whatever. We just wanted to kind of integrate that together in one system. We actually also in this database put anytime there's an accident, we would do our follow-up investigation with this database as well. So we're collecting it in one place. We're collecting basically what investigations we performed throughout the year and how we followed up. So.
How many investigations is it typical to conduct in a year?
Well, that's the question. Making it anonymous basically allows it open to the public. So if we feel like the database, because it's a web-based form, if we feel like it's being abused or, you know, there needs to be some more constraint on it, we might need to change it. So we've put it into effect in late January, I think, is when it went up. I think we have a total of 27 issues so far that we've investigated. And some of them are, you know, relatively minor. They walked in and said there was a door open in biology and the door's supposed to be closed. Most of those we just follow up with an email to the person in charge, letting them know, by the way, your door was seen open. So it's not taking a great deal of our time. So far it's worked well. As we market it more and make it more known, I'm sure that it might become more of a demand on our time, but I think it's a good system so far. Yeah?
I have a specific question. As you know, I'm on the Radiation and Laser Safety Committee.
Yes.
And you included magnetic fields in that.
Right.
To the best of my knowledge, that's never been addressed by the committee.
To be honest, I don't know if it was addressed by our office. It was never really addressed by the committee. I don't know if we need to add it to the committee's responsibilities, because there's fairly narrow guidelines about what the exposure to magnetic fields is, and it's a pretty well accepted standard. I know that in the past, it's kind of been, like in chemistry, for instance, in the NMR rooms, you know, we would go in and recommend. Right, there's a sign. Right, and that's mostly the limit to a majority of this. But what I feel that we need to do is we need to go in and, I guess, audit the program regularly so that it's not just a one-time thing, you know. I don't know if we're actually going in and looking at those labs. And that's something that I think Matthew and Ruben, our radiation laser safety team, would be perfect at doing. It's a way to address, a hazard. We've also put an MRI machine in this building, and Earl addressed that, but with a safety plan. So what I'd like to do is make sure that we're following up on that with regular inspections to make sure that there's nothing that's glaringly deficient in what was originally created in the safety plan. Okay, we could have done this with a much smaller room, but if you ever need to contact me, I have my business card available. You can also go to our website. It's ehs.ttu.edu. And all the information that I presented here is available there, as well as the scan system. And it'll have links to the lessons learned page. So if you ever have questions that come up, you're welcome to go there anytime, or you're welcome to call our office and we'll direct the call to where it needs to go. All right, well, thank you very much for your time.